Hello and welcome. In today's video, we're going to talk about some of the emulators that stood out the most throughout this year. We saw projects that nearly doubled their performance, others that appeared out of nowhere and quickly became reference points for the consoles they aimed to emulate, and even initiatives that reached over 98% compatibility. A lot has happened, so get comfortable and come along. And before we get too deep into the video, go ahead and drop a like, and if this is your first time here, consider subscribing to keep up with the upcoming content. Starting with GameFusion Lite. I know it's technically not a traditional emulator, but I felt it deserved a mention. You probably already know GameFusion, that solution that allows Windows games to run on Android. But this year, GameFusion Lite appeared, a completely clean version without bloatware, without data collection, and without the requirement of extra accounts to access the app. This cleanup removed unnecessary processes and even brought a small performance boost, which always matters on an Android device where every frame counts. But the story took a strange turn. The main developer suddenly abandoned the project and claimed that the EmuReady team would continue the work. The problem is that there's still no version from them. Maybe because the emulator hasn't been updated, maybe because the new team hasn't started working yet. For now, the future of the Lite Edition remains completely uncertain. Now let's move on to an emulator that debuted this year and arrived making a strong first impression, Aimer, a Sega Saturn emulator. The Saturn has always been a technical labyrinth, almost a living puzzle, thanks to its two GPUs that work completely independently from each other, one focused on sprites and the other on 3D, with no direct communication between them. This architecture has always been a nightmare for anyone trying to create an accurate emulator. Even so, Aimer, still in an experimental state, already runs more than 90% of the console's library. Of course, many basic features are still missing and the emulator is far from complete, but what the developer has achieved so far shows massive potential. I hope it continues to surprise me in the coming year. Speaking of the Saturn, another emulator that many considered abandoned but returned with force is Yaba Sanshiro. It has always been seen as one of the best Saturn emulators, offering useful graphical enhancements like polygon correction, sprite upscaling, and anti-aliasing filters. Even so, its development had stopped for years. The turning point came during the Saturn's 30th anniversary event last year, and since then, the project has been receiving consistent updates again. It's now possible to sync save states between Android and PC in the paid version, the compatibility list improved significantly, and new controllers like the 8-bit Duo M30 were added, providing the perfect experience for anyone who wants to enjoy everything the Saturn offered at its peak. Moving on to the PlayStation 2, PCSX2 remains strong as the best emulator available today, reaching nearly 100% playable games, surpassing 4,300 titles. At the time of this recording, the only games still unplayable are Stuntman, Marvel Nemesis, Rise of the Imperfects, and the Final Fantasy XI series, which depends on online servers and a subscription to function. Besides that, the emulator has surpassed the original console in almost every way, even offering online multiplayer support between PC users, console users, and other emulators. So, if you haven't updated PCSX2 in a while, it's worth downloading the latest version. On Android, EtherSX2 also received important improvements throughout the year, expanding its compatibility and bringing real performance gains. Today, it remains the best option for anyone who wants to play PlayStation 2 on Android. We also had the rise of ARMSX2, a port of PCSX2 with ARM recompilers. I tested several games with it, and despite the huge potential to become as good, or even better than NetherSX2 in the future, it's still not worth replacing your NetherSX2 just yet. It lacks basic features, some functions are still buggy, and the overall experience falls short when compared to EtherSX2. Even so, it's worth keeping an eye on it to see if it eventually catches up and maybe even surpasses its competition. Now let's talk about Azahor, which continues to collect controversies and add unnecessary DRM. We had the case of Azahor Plus, and more recently, the blockade that prevented other emulators from accessing CKGP7, the Mario Kart 7 mod. The emulator itself hasn't evolved much this year, although it's also true that it's already at a stage where it doesn't need that many improvements. Support for two separate screens on Android was added, taking advantage of dual-screen devices or setups with an external display. Even so, I'm not a fan of the direction the project is taking, especially because of the restrictions, DRM, and barriers created even for content considered abandonware. All of that only complicates usage and ends up hurting the community. Shad PS4 was another major highlight this year. The emulator managed to literally double the FPS in Bloodborne, which remains the game where it shines the most and practically the reason it was created. But that wasn't all. The compatibility list grew significantly, including important titles like Dead or Alive 5, The Last Guardian, Drive Club, and even God of War 3 starting to show signs of gameplay. Some people believe it might run God of War 3 decently before RPCS3 does on a mid-range PC. At its current stage, there are still missing textures, lighting issues, and other problems in the environments, but the progress is undeniable. Shad PS4 also sparked controversy when the developers removed the file installation feature, claiming it contributed to piracy, which split the community. And to counter all these restrictions that several emulators started implementing as anti-piracy measures, a few heroes stepped in to bypass everything. The team behind Azahor Plus developed both Azahor Plus and Shad PS4 Plus, forks created specifically to return to the community some of the features that had been removed. CTGP7 was blocked on this fork, and that ended up causing conflict between the Azahor team and the Azahor Plus team, including disputes over the brand name itself. On the Shad PS4 side, no one seems to care much about what the forks are doing. Even so, these forks gained attention for preventing users from having to rely on third-party tools. Not all heroes wear capes. Another emulator that appeared less throughout the year, but still delivered real improvements in testing, was RPCS3. In some games, I saw performance increases of up to 25%. In the game you're seeing in the background, for example, at the beginning of the year I could only reach around 25 FPS, while now it stays at 60 FPS most of the time. Even with a high-end PC using an AM5 processor and DDR5 RAM, this game used to be tough to handle. Some might say that RPCS3 is still far from perfect since many PlayStation 3 exclusives still don't run properly. But considering the complex engineering Sony created back then, reaching the current level of compatibility is already a massive achievement. Before we move on to the Switch emulators, remember to leave a like so this video can reach more people. And if this is your first time here, consider subscribing so you don't miss the next updates. If you want to buy original games while saving a lot, check out Instant Gaming, the digital store that sells games for various platforms, such as PC, PlayStation, Xbox, and Nintendo Switch. Get games of all genres with discounts of up to 95%. You'll also find a variety of gift cards and credits for other services. You can pay for your order through your credit card on a website with a 4.7 rating on Trustpilot. You're buying games directly from Instant Gaming, not from other retailers. If you encounter any issues, Instant Gaming offers 24/7 support. And this month, Instant Gaming is offering a special discount on Wuchang, with a price at least $10 cheaper than on Steam, making it the lowest price ever for the game. What are you waiting for to save? Links in the description. Alright, now let's go. Before talking about the two emulators that truly dominated this year, I want to mention that I'll make a separate video focusing solely on them, going over everything in more detail. So consider this part a general summary. Let's start with Citroën. Even though it didn't have the best year due to DRM, console verification, and some internal disputes, things are back on track now, and I can confidently say the emulator is stable and reliable again. The community is extremely active and delivered things that had been highly anticipated, like the audio fix for firmware 19 and the ability to install updates designed for the Nintendo Switch 2, including new languages and small additional content for several games. From day one, Citroën showed that it was here to replace Yuzu for good. It went through turbulence, but today it's back at its peak. Having direct access to the developers, suggesting ideas, and clearing up doubts is easy, and this constant dialogue is the project's biggest strength. Working in parallel yet still in proximity to Eden helps the entire scene grow much faster. Speaking of Eden, it didn't slow down either. The project brought important innovations, especially on Android, where several games are optimized exclusively for it. One of Eden's biggest contributions was the implementation of CTGP Deluxe, the Mario Kart 8 Deluxe mod. The compatibility list grew with over 50 games fixed throughout the year, and today it's probably the Switch emulator with the highest overall compatibility. Performance, especially in JRPGs, remains its strongest point. If you're a fan of the genre, Eden is still the best choice. It arrived to retire Yuzu, especially on Android. It's an emulator full of fresh ideas, including features that haven't even reached Citroën yet. And that wraps up today's video. Is there any emulator you think should be on this list? Leave it in the comments below. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.